this particular segment, I want to talk about artists like Cab Calloway, especially Pigmeat Markham, even the Nicholas Brothers, the Mills Brothers, the Jubilaires, and recent conversations that have been coming into the larger conversation as far as their influence and impact on hip hop, rap music specifically, and the larger hip hop culture. So first, I like to say there is an influence, certainly. But we've started to hear things like, well, the first rap record was Pigmeat Markham. And, you know, or Cab Calloway was the first rap, you know, the rap artist. Or, you know, we're hearing these different things. And one thing that I like to provide when I speak is context to these conversations. Now, you could say that Pigmeat Markham was the first rap record, but you have to put context to it. Here comes the judge. It was definitely speaking in syncopation over a beat.
Yeah, he, the cold up swings. It's just about ready to do that thing. I don't want no tears, I don't want no lies. Above all, I don't want no alibis. This judge is hip, and that ain't all. He'll give you time if you're big or small. Fall in line or this coat is neat. Peace, brother.
Oh, here comes the judge. Here comes the judge. Everybody know that he is the judge.
Certainly, but you have to look first at that particular segment and what rap music is. Okay, rapping before it was a musical genre in urban neighborhoods and black neighborhoods, rapping was just talking. You know, you'd be rapping to a female. Yeah, H-Rap Brown, the activist who spoke in rhyme. You had Muhammad Ali was rapping. I remember The Moments, who eventually became Ray Goodman and Brown. They had a song called Baby, Let's Rap Now. Isaac Hayes had a series of songs called Ike's Rap because he talked through the songs. So rapping didn't have to be speaking in rhyme, but it was generally speaking. And many times it was speaking in rhyme. So this goes back to the blaxploitation era of black movies. It goes back to jailhouse culture. It goes back to playing the dozens. It goes back to the signifying monkey. All these things are very, very much within urban subculture. And they developed and changed and morphed into different things over the years. So we have to keep that in mind. So you can look at video of the Berry Brothers or the Nicholas Brothers, the Mills Brothers, and they're doing moves that look a lot like what modern day breakdancing would be. And you have people speaking in rhyme long before Sugar Hill Records and Joey Records or any of what we call the modern day rappers, before King Tim or any of that. It may be a good idea to go back and look at my 20 or so of the first rap recordings. And these were modern day rap recordings. And you'll get a little more context. So what we have here is, again, part of a subculture that has morphed into something else. So I break down this, what I call jive talking, into three categories. Now that doesn't mean it's just three, it could be several more, but I break them down into three categories of what I consider early rapping. So you had the street jive talk, which was very much, very braggadocious. This is the, you had like Frankie Crocker, you know, legendary DJ, rest in peace, radio DJ, WBLS, legendary, in music, in the world of soul music, urban music. He spoke in rhyme, and it was almost had like a pimp type element to it, and definitely braggadocious, always talking about what they could do. That's what these particular guys would speak about. Rudy Ray Moore, Muhammad Ali, even the blaxploitation era of movies, the rhymes you would hear were always about, I can do this, I can do that, you know, I can sell ice to an Eskimo, you know, things that are pretty much ridiculous, but a metaphor for how cool I am, you know. And you go all the way back to Temptations, who weren't rhyming on this particular song, but when they made I Can't Get Next to You, you know, they were saying these things that were like these super things. I could do this with a single grain of sand, but I can't get next to you. So I'm not saying that influenced rap, but it's the same thing. These these early bragging young men were talking about their sexual prowess, how cool they were. And in general, it was a thing where, you know, you're talking about a group of people, a race of people, really, who have been through a traumatic experience. And not even 100 years after that traumatic experience, as a form of saying, hey, this is who we are. I'm not who I was defined as through, you know, through the system of American oppression. This is who I am. We took it all the way in the other direction. So I'm not what I was defined as here. I'm this.
And you'll be cleaned in a boy's house.
Why not? I'm as free as the breeze, and I do as I please. Besides, don't take nothing but a little money. Here you go, baby.
Well, lovey, you're a scholar and a gentleman.
Thank you. Say, sweet me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now, I don't mean to be dipping into y'all's business, but I've been listening to you dudes talk about women, and I want to run down a little something to you. Now, all you need to get a woman is a strong rap. Hey, what I say. Every woman in the streets wants a piece of me. They call me Sweet Peter Jeter, the broom beater. The baby maker and the cradle shaker. The deer slayer, the buck binder, and the women's finder. I am known from the Gold Coast to the rocky shores of Maine. Fun loving is my name. And love is my game.
Said love is my game.
I'm the bed tucker, the milkshaker, the record breaker, and the population maker. The humdinger, the gunslinger, and the baby bringer. I am fun loving the hard hitter and the poly noose getter. The judge, the sludge, the women's pet, the men's fret, and the faggot's pinnacle. Trickster. I said fun loving the cherry picker, the city slicker, and the titty wicker. I ain't giving up nothing but bubble gum and hard time, and I'm fresh out of bubble gum. Oh, I'm the man who walked the water and tied the whale's tail in a knot. I taught the fish how to swim, crossed the burning sand, and shook the devil's hand. I roamed the world on a snail can of sack that said, cow mail. I walk 49 miles of barbed wire and I use a cobra snake for a necktie. Yes, I'm him, the women pimp. Women fight for my delight. I am a bad dude. Johnny Ripsaw, the devil's son-in-law. I gave a highway patrolman a speeding ticket and sold a blind man a flashlight. In the world that knows why white milk make yellow buttons. I even know where the lights go when you cut the switch off. Now, I might not be the baddest man in the world, but I'm in the top two, and my father is getting old.
Shit, father is getting old. You really suck.
Ladies and gentlemen, there are seven acknowledged wonders of the world. You are about to be entertained by the eighth, the young man who has become a legend in his own time, Soulfinger, Agent 00 Soul. It's the Frankie Crocker Show.
Do it, Frankie. Do it to it.
Suck it to me, mama. Say, baby, this is an album that's bound to put more dips in your hips, more cut in your strut, and more glide in your stride. If you don't dig it, you know you've got a hole in your soul. Don't eat chicken on Sunday. Push, girl. Other cats be laughing and joking. Frankie Crocker steady taking care of business, cooking and smoking. For there is no other like this soul brother, tall, tan, young, and fly. Anytime you want me, baby, I'm your guy. Oh, young and single, and I love to mingle. Can I mingle with you, baby? Closer than whites on rice, closer than coals on ice, closer than a collar's on a dog, closer than a hammer's on a country horn. Gonna get next to you, mama.
So that's one section, was the actual braggadocious, street job talk. But then you had guys who took that speaking and they made it political. You had the Last Poets. You had the Watts Prophets. You had Gil Scott Heron. You had Gary Bird. Gary Bird, again, was a radio disc jockey. The disc jockeys were early with this rhyming speak, too. And we'll speak to that. But the political guys, the guys who talked about what was happening on the front lines in the black community, those guys were rhyming as well, or what you would call rapping. And they didn't necessarily refer to it as rap. You never heard the Last Poets say much about I'm rapping, if they ever said it on a song. But that's what they were doing. Rapping in the black community, in the urban community, was just talking. Not necessarily over a beat at all, and not necessarily rhyming. You're just talking.
It's time for us to face the truth and level with each other. It's time for us to face the fact that every brother ain't a brother. There are some who say to the world at large, I'm no color, I'm just a man. And there are some who say to the folks of town that black power is not their plan. But through it all, we kid ourselves and fool one another by failing to see the simple fact that every brother ain't a brother. I mean, a brother wants his people to have the things they need to survive. And a brother doesn't destroy his brother. He fights to keep him alive. A brother doesn't live off other brothers. He makes it.
You will not be able to stay home, brother. You will not be able to plug in, turn on, and cop out. You will not be able to lose yourself on Skag and skip out for beer during commercials because the revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by Xerox in four parts without commercial interruptions. The revolution will not show you pictures of Nixon blowing a bugle and leading a charge by John Mitchell, General Abrams, and Spiro Agnew to eat hog maws confiscated from a Harlem sanctuary. The revolution will not be televised. The revolution will not be brought to you by the Schaefer Award Theater and will not star Natalie Woods and Steve McQueen or Bullwinkle and Julia.
You have nothing to say, just a hearing and obey. Just silently playing your roles while others decide whether you live or die. And madmen man the controls. You have nothing to say, just a hearing and obey. You're just a silently playing your roles while others decide whether you live or die. And madmen man the controls. It's a quarter to the hour and the superpowers are standing toe to toe. They are talking slick and you moving quick and the whole thing's about to blow. They are acting tough and calling bluff. So while the human masses cringe and rear, knowing one mistake concealed their fate, they might not see another year.
So that was the second category. And the last category in the three that I have are DJs. These are mainly radio personalities like Jocko Henderson, rest in peace. Hank Spann, rest in peace. Gary Bird. Gary Bird, he crossed a couple of them. You know, he was in the political category, but he's also in the DJ category. And these guys, and of course, Frankie Crocker. You know, he crossed the jive talking category and he comes over all, as well into the category of the DJs. Now, these guys, again, their cadence was very important and popular. I know a lot of people contacted me, you know, they got a little kick out of my imitation of some of the early radio DJs and their cadence. You know, it's very much the cadence that Big Bang Hank came with. Grandmaster Caz had a lot of that cadence. Even Wonder Mike from the Sugar Hill Gang, they had that radio disc jockey cadence. Like I said, in the place to be would be like that's their cadence.
WWRL in New York. This is Hank Spann. Definitely glad to have you there for my Saturday affair.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.
WWRL.
New York. York.
In New York, the server dealing the feeling inside your mind on a beautiful Saturday afternoon. 69 sunny degrees. 3 o'clock in the Big Apple. Gladys Knight, the Pips getting down. 5 on the survey. Daddy can swear. Oh, I declare. WWRL, the server dealing the feeling at 251. Inside your mind with Skull Snaps. Fantastically funky music from Skull Snaps LP. The jam's called It's a New Day. 254 in New York on a Saturday with a server sweet swinging.
E to the yuck. Ho, this is Jock and I'm back on the scene with the record machine saying goodbye to. How do you do?
Later on, when you got into modern day rap, you had people like DJ Hollywood and others who syncopated it and made it more on the beat. But in that same time frame of these things happening, you had Pig Meat Markham's record, Here Come the Judge, which he was speaking syncopated, very much so. But let me discuss why these things are not directly related to hip hop. Some of them are not related to it at all. They did influence, but it's not hip hop. When you have somebody that's doing separate parts of something that makes up a whole, that doesn't mean that they're doing that whole. So what I mean is, if our loose definition of hip hop is MCing, DJing, graffiti, and b-boying, and somebody was doing a version of these, one of these elements, one or more of these elements, before we named it hip hop and proclaimed that these are the parts, that doesn't make it hip hop, because hip hop didn't exist yet until, you know, till my generation came along and we said, hey, these things make up this particular subculture. So the fact that somebody was doing something that was very close to it or even influenced it does not make it that. Now, I'm not trying to split hairs here, but I am trying to give some clarity to a record like Here Come the Judge. Pig Meat Markham was not an MC, and he did not claim to be an MC. He was a guy that was talking rhythmically over a record. MCs are masters of ceremony, and a master of ceremony is he's the host. He's the host of the party. Now, you remember in my previous lessons, I said that the original MC was the DJ, because the hip hop DJ used to try to talk over the records that he spun. And many hip hop DJs, especially a DJ like Flash, he was so busy manipulating the records and making an art form out of it that it wasn't feasible for him to speak. But most importantly, he didn't like his speaking voice. So he employed MCs that just MC'd. You had DJs that, like I said, most DJs talked in some kind of way. But people like Flash and Herc and others early, Bambaataa, they all employed MCs to speak. And in the beginning, the MC spoke mostly about their DJ and how good the DJ was. Go back to any old school recording. Go back to the names of these groups, Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five, Grand Wizard Theodore and the Fantastic Five. The DJ's name was always first. And the MC talked about the greatness of the DJ. So Cab Calloway, even though he's very much in the early days of call and response, I'm sure somebody in hip hop saw something and said, hey, you know, whether they saw it directly from Cab Calloway or Cab Calloway inspired somebody who inspired rap. Some of that call and response, most definitely. Call and response comes from the church. But Cab Calloway never had a DJ. Cab Calloway never rhymed over breakbeats. He never rhymed in syncopation. He never claimed to be an MC. And these fraternity of people who call themselves MCs, they performed at certain places. No matter what city you were in, there was a very much fraternal thing to it. That these guys that came 20, 30 years before that and even more had nothing to do with. So Pig Meat Markham was not speaking about his DJ because he didn't have a DJ. He was not speaking over breakbeats. You know, this culture started with parties, outdoor parties in the beginning. And the MC and DJ speaking braggadociously most of the time, getting the party people motivated, speaking over breakbeats. And Pig Meat Markham was not doing that. The Last Poets weren't doing that. They definitely inspired some of us who went on to do that. Even I call some of the segues and rhymes, I call them community rhymes, because there were certain rhymes everybody said. You listen to some of those early rap recordings or the early tapes of live performances, and everybody said dip, dip, dive, so socialized. Everybody said hotel, motel, Holiday Inn. There were rhymes that everybody borrowed. As a segue, everybody said yes, yes, y'all, to the beat, y'all. You don't stop, keep on. Something that is credited to my brother, Kid Creole. You know, these things, you know, we may never know who did it first, you know, but there's a true statement. There's nothing new under the sun. And as it goes with what we're seeing here, there's nothing new under the sun. But at the same time, you know, I'm motivated to do this off of the fact that I see this being a bigger conversation because of the technology we have available now to share things. We didn't have even 25 years ago, 20 years ago, the technology in place to see a video like the one by the Jubilaires, where this is a gospel group sometime in the 30s, and they're speaking almost syncopated. You know, and they're doing these little gospel rhymes, and the cadence of one of their rhymes is almost like Rapper's Delight. Very, very much like it.
Yes, just come on, brothers, if you want to hear a story about that preacher and the bear. Gather round, boys, I don't want you to miss none of this here story, cause it goes like this. A preacher, he went out to hunting. It was on one Sunday morning. Though he was one Christian young man, but he took his gun along. Well, the first thing he shot was a bunch of fine quails, and he shot him a nice fat hare. Then through the woods on his way back home, he met a great big grizzly bear. Then the reverend fell down upon his knees. He sent up a great long prayer. Whilst he cast one eye to the heaven on high, but kept the other eye on the bear. He said,
an indirect influence. But again, these guys are not claiming to be MCs. They are not part of this fraternity of people who call themselves MCs, DJs, and the like. Did they influence it? Definitely. Did they directly influence it? Probably not. They came too far. I doubt very seriously that Wonder Mike from the Sugar Hill Gang, who set off Rapper's Delight, I doubt very seriously he was going into his parents' records and heard the Jubilaires and said, I'm gonna do what this guy's doing. These records weren't popular, records by the Jubilaires and people like that. And Cab Calloway was immensely popular. So it was Pig Meat Markham and people like that. But these influences are indirect. They're passed down through generations. They're seen in the blaxploitation movies. You can watch some of these blaxploitation movies and you hear the jive talk. And this jive talk, some of it is the same jive talk that we would adapt not even a decade later and put into the music. So there is an influence there. But for the sake of conversation and keeping it clear, I don't call Pig Meat Markham the first rap record, because if the only criteria is that he's speaking, you could go back 30 years before him and the Jubilaires were speaking and others were speaking, and they were speaking almost syncopated. But that is not what modern day rap music is. Modern day rap music added a lot to that, a lot to it, and made it its own fraternal thing and added other elements, the DJ, and later on the B-boy and the graffiti artist. There are many differences. So in this compare and contrast, you know, in closing, many, many similarities. But again, because you're doing parts of a whole does not mean that you're participating in the whole. Because again, the whole did not exist until, you know, almost 40 years after the 1930s, you know. And did people borrow? Yes, they did. Most likely indirectly. But that does not make Cab Calloway, Hank Spann, and these guys hip hop. And they never claimed to be. But very much the forefathers, the forerunners, and influencers, definitely, no doubt about it.